Welcome to this lecture in heat transfer, where we look at natural convection in enclosed spaces. The learning goals of this lecture are understanding the influence of heated and cooled surfaces in enclosed spaces, to be able to decide how to look at your configuration as a vertical or horizontal arrangement of natural convection, and to get an overview of the different applications that exist for enclosed spaces. Here's our overview of classification of convection problems according to the flow regime. We looked at forced convection external, internal. We looked at free convection external, and now we're going to look at free convection internal, and that is the dashed red box. Of course, in all cases, we have the additional distinguishment, and that is between turbulent and laminar flow. Convection in enclosed spaces is examples are shown here. To the left, you see a room with a radiator at the left side, and here the radiator heats the air, and a convection roll, a convection current, starts to exist in the room that in fact transports heat from the radiator to, for example, the outer walls. And to the right side, you see the opposite. That is where we have a window that is cool, and the window that is cool near the window, the air will go below, and we'll have a convection roll, a convection current that is going to go anti-clockwise, and that brings in fact cold, that in fact heats the air here, and that cools the air on the other sides. The characteristic distance that we will use is the distance S that is between the heated and the cooled surface, and we'll use that as a characteristic length of the problem, and the temperatures of the walls are the driving temperatures of the convection. As a reminder, I'm showing you this slide from the first lecture, natural convection in a room. In the top, we have a cold window with a radiator below it. And if we look at the radiator, heats the air rises and then moves in a counterclockwise rotation and then returns across the floor. And we see that the cold air from the that is dropping near the window mixes with the hot air that is rising, and so we have air with a mixed temperature moving around. And in the second case, where we had the radiator on the other side of the room, we had the cold air dropping, moving over the floor to the radiator, there being heated, and there we predominantly had cold air moving over the floor. And these are two convection configurations in a closed environment, in an enclosure. Typically, we distinguish different configurations. The one is a vertical enclosure that is shown here to the right with temperatures T1 and T2, and a length H, a height H, and a characteristic distance S. And for this case, we can look at the convection roll that will start to form between T1 and T2. First of all, the parameter that determines the behavior, the dimensionless parameter, is going to be the Grassof number. And the Grassof number was the ratio of the buoyancy forces to the viscous forces. And we will only have convection when the buoyancy forces have become large enough compared to the viscous forces. That means there is a threshold for natural convection to start. And below this threshold of the Grassof number, we only have heat conduction, which means that the Nusselt number then is 1. Then we have the laminar range. And for this case, the laminar range is between 2000 and 20,000. And there the Nusselt number, the average Nusselt number, is given as 0.2 h over s to the power 1 over 9. And that's the configuration related to the geometry. And then we have Grassof times Prandtl to the power 1 over 4. And the 1 over 4 was indeed, as we have seen before, for external convection, the power for the case of laminar flow. In the turbulent range, for the larger values of the Grassof number, we have Nusselt number is, again, a geometrical factor, and then multiplying Grassof times Prandtl to the power 1 over 3. Now, this combination we have seen before. In natural convection, we always have Grassof times Prandtl, and Grassof times Prandtl is also called the Rayleigh number. And here, Grassof based on S, then we have the Rayleigh number also based on S. and we'll get back to the Rayleigh number. The numbers here, they indicate, of course, the equation numbers in your reader. Next, we look at a horizontal surface, and this here can we look, we will look at the case where the lower surface T2 is hot and the upper surface T1 is cold. In that case, we will have convection, because then the fluid near the hot surface will decrease in density and will move upwards, and the fluid near the cold surface will increase in density and move downwards. So then we indeed can transport heat from one surface to the other one. If we look in the literature and on internet, we can find some nice display of results. First, we see for the case of a very small temperature difference, for a small Rayleigh number, Grashof number, that the upper surface is cool, the lower surface is warm. We do not really have a flow yet, so this is pure conduction. Then when the Rayleigh number exceeds about 1700 or something close to 2000, we start to have these convection rolls, and there can be multiple rolls in a configuration that depends on the width. And then when the Grashof number increases even more, we will have turbulent flow, that is where we have all kind of motion in the enclosure. The results here were taken from a paper that I found on the internet and is available online, open source, and that's turning up the heat in turbulent thermal convection for Mr. Döring, and you can look for more results in that paper. A nice animation of the turbulent flow in a Rayleigh Bernard cell, as this is called, I'm going to show you now. The lower surface is heated and the upper surface is cooled. And you can see how, for this case, we really see the turbulence in the flow. And we get a very intense mixing of hot and cold fluid, which then really accelerates the heat transfer. And this is a numerical simulation for a two-dimensional case. In three-dimensional, these motions take place in very interesting cells and shapes. And this is one of the classic problems studied in physics, Rayleigh-Bernard convection. Now we have seen the phenomena that take place in the flow in a horizontal enclosure, we can start to look at the correlations that exist for the heat transfer in this enclosure. The ones that we show here were taken from a publication of Holman in 1976, and these were obtained from experimental results. The numbers again indicate the numbers in your reader. So first of all, for a Grashof number that is too low, we will have only heat conduction and no fluid motion. If we have a laminar fluid motion, then we'll have an average Nusselt number that is 0.21 times Rayleigh or Grashof times Prandtl to the power 1 over 4. And in the turbulent range, we have a similar relation with a different prefactor. But then, and here we have a power 1 over 3. In the same way as we had for other natural convection problems. And this is again for the case heating from below. There are many more cases like this. There are enclosures at an angle, and these you can find in handbooks. In all cases, it is important to check the Grashof number, to check the range of validity, and then you can apply the relation for the case that you have in mind. The comprehension questions here are, first of all, why is heat generally transferred between two horizontal surfaces in a fluid layer only by conduction when the upper plate is heated? This requires a little bit of thinking. Gravity is pointing downwards. If we look at a hot plate at the top, then the density near the hot plate will decrease, and then it would like to rise. And it cannot rise because the plate is at the top. So that indicates why we will not have fluid motion, we only have conduction. There is one exception to this rule, and that's a very interesting one, and that I'm going to show you now. This exception is water between 4 and 0 degrees. And here is the density of water as a function of temperature. And you can see that between 0 and 4 degrees, the density of water actually increases. And this has striking effect, and that is the freezing of water in a pond or on a river. River not so quickly because it's moving, but on more or less stagnant water. It means that when the water near the surface cools down to 4 degrees, it will be denser than the remaining water. And that means that it will sink to the bottom. And this turnover then leads to a layer of warmer water that approaches the surface, which is also then cooled. And eventually the entire pond, the entire volume of water, has a temperature that is about 4 degrees. Now if the temperature of the surface then drops below the 4 degrees, the water is less dense, the water at the top is then less dense than the water below, so then it stays near the top. So then we have a complete layer of water on the top of the pond that has a density that is lighter. When the temperature further drops, this layer is going to freeze when we go towards 0 degrees. And so the ice, and then we have a pond that is 4 degrees below the ice, and the ice on top of the liquid water then also provides an insulating layer. And this allows then fish and other forms of aquatic life to survive in the 4 degrees water below. And that is a special characteristic of water, and it's closely related to life on our planet. And of course it's closely related to many other things too. For example, the fun that many people have in ice skating, and in the Netherlands when we have ice conditions, then people start to go outside quite a lot and very enthusiastically. And here's a picture taken on natural ice near a famous place, Kinderdijk, with some windmills. And I hope this is an interesting fun fact that helps you to motivate you to learn the heat transfer. And thank you for your attention for this lecture.